the change logs on the hero specific buffs and nerfs, there's not too many huge differences. I mean, maybe Crystal Maiden is an important one to point out. Sure, her Crystal Nova, her first skill is really strong right now in the regular patch. And right now for her, it does 100. In real life right now, it does 130 damage for 130 mana. And in this patch, it's 100 damage for 100 mana. So it's significantly less, but the mana cost is one for
yeah,
one. So
equally efficient. So.
And most heroes, no changes. No. Like the very small stuff, it'll be like a talent tree is slightly better, something like that.
So here we have it. Ladies and gentlemen, as you can see, both teams getting to pick straight up. We have, of course, Dota Arena being the humans on stage and at the top OpenAI. They've made their selections and we are getting ready to go straight into this first match as we are going to see how well the audience fares against OpenAI. Kevin, we've seen the picks. Anything that sort of screams out to you as a big no-no or a big yes-yes?
I think probably the biggest thing is that Necro 2 patches ago was actually really bad. So I think right off the bat, that's probably one of the heroes that's gotten the most across-the-board buffs at level 1. He has better attack animation, his death pulse is better, he's got more scaling regen on death pulse. I think this is maybe a weak pick here in this patch. It's probably somebody I'd avoid. But he's committed. You can't go back now.
Let's see what we have in terms of the way that they are going to approach the lanes. At the moment, OpenAI having the DP go solo bottom. The other four of them at the moment sort of hovering around this top lane. We'll see how much sort of how much focus they put on the runes, for instance, at the spawn point.
Yeah, it's a normal Sir Action Slack style is cross the river, steal their bounty runes, and fight them. Something he doesn't do is buy small efficient items like Stout Shield, and we actually have a couple of these already. They're actually going to engage here online. Like Earthshaker is carrying a Stout Shield, super abnormal, and even Tidehunter, a hero that skills Kraken Shell, his Stout Shield's instantly more or less worthless. He's also got a Stout Shield, so this makes me assume that they're going to want to go tank creeps.
Yeah, we'll see in terms of sort of how that affects his skill build as well. The fact that he's got that may be able to allow him to go a bit more offensive with the Anchor Smash and the Gush. But top lane, OpenAI trying to kick things off. They get a beautiful paralyzing cast between the two of them. And it goes well with the Rocket Barrage, but not quite enough damage to bring down Slark and Lion. They'll be able to keep their distance, but OpenAI already stepping up the aggression here.
And the couriers are off moving. They're bringing regen. So this is something that you could also see from their starting item builds. Not a lot of regen on the OpenAI team. And if you look at the Dota strategy right now, that's absolutely prevalent. It's that if you get a deny on an enemy creep, you're getting as much experience from that creep as they are. So if you can get every last hit and deny from the creep wave, you're getting massively more experience than your opponents. So it's really important that they zone enemy heroes like this with good trades so that they can control the experience and the golden lane. And that's what OpenAI is doing here. They're bullying this Lion and Slark in a huge way.
Oh, look at that Fissure as well. With that wraparound, they've set up for the first blood. OpenAI off to a hot start with this aggressive
top lane. It's tanking the tower. We heard that this might happen, and it's already beginning. So the Sentry Wards take 8 right clicks from a tower here, which buys them time. I'm surprised they placed it so early, though. That seemed a little bit bizarre. In fact, they could have used a Tango maybe to heal off of that. Maybe something to abuse there, but that was pretty weird.
How do you reckon these other lanes are sort of going to match up? OpenAI sending the Tidehunter 1v1 mid against the Viper. So far in CS, as you can see, 3-for-1 against the 2-for-2. It's close, early days between the two of them.
Definitely not a normal lane, that's for sure. They're going to find the Earthshaker here, but he's going to actually teleport out after the stun came out. He knows that much at least.
And does teleport all the way back to base.
And the other lane, is a Death Prophet versus a Necrophos. So because Necro is actually really weak in this patch, I think this is going to be a tough lane. Death Prophet, this is like the peak of Death Prophet's strength. She actually got a couple nerfs immediately after this patch. So, and she was actually ran as a safe lane hero in this patch as well. So this is pretty much ideal from opening. Using a smoke on the top lane though,
see if they can make something happen.
It's instantly broken as they run at their opponents. So we saw a little bit of the previous game that was played. We saw a lot of bizarre smoke usage, actually, just like this. It's like, I need to walk somewhere a quarter of a second faster, and they pop it.
I'm going to try with the cast. Eye is going to bounce over to the rest of them, so Lion should be fine. He's able to keep his distance away from the OpenAI. Mid lane. Actually have the tie getting relatively low, but he's prepared, does have that salve ready. Pops it immediately. So he's ready to return back to the lane.
Yeah, they don't waste seconds here. They know what the limits of the enemy heroes are, and they're going to back at the right time and pop a salve to get right back into it. Oh! It starts.
And look at this, Kev. Not the best dewarding here.
That's very interesting. I'm not sure what those are for. There's a lot of wards in this top lane, though. They're actually placing wards all over the place.
I'm going to see maybe the Shaker in trouble there, in fact. Just get the Fissure out, which will stop the Lion from closing the gap to get this stun off.
How come this Crystal Maiden doesn't have his aura? Come on.
Not approving of the human skill build.
The 110 is not the skill build. You need Arcane Aura so you can pump mana to your teammates. It's really important, actually. Allows them to cast more spells, to harass better, to win their lanes, essentially. And if you don't get that until later, it's going to really delay your team's ability to win this.
All things said and done, the first 3 minutes, not going too bad for the humans here in this. It's less than a 1k lead. I mean, OpenAI with just the one kill, but it may be more here as the Earthshaker getting aggressive up top.
You saw that trash talk. It was 80% already.
Here we go.
Good.
They're diving. They will get one here with the Rocket Barrage. Can they get more? They're a little low, OpenAI. Slark, CM trying to turn. He has got the Frostbite back up. And will turn towards the Gyre and take it. So they'll get another. Slark keeping his distance. And he's going to be fine. So OpenAI will not get that second kill. And they will have to retreat. Shaker TP's out. And we see a kill get caught in return.
Oh, another smoke. There goes another 160 gold for Witch Doctor here. Playing position 5, literally, but not quite executing perfectly. CM in trouble, though.
And they run in. They've got the setup with the cask into the Rocket Barrage. Another kill for OpenAI.
It's one of the hardest things laning against Darkcropter is that he just does so much with the skill points early. That seems to be what OpenAI is abusing. They just want these laning heroes that deal a huge amount of damage right at the start of the game. And we have Tide rotating, even. He's sitting ready to die, but all he's got is Anchor Smash and Kraken.
See down bottom as well. We might see a bit of a solo kill. Same time actually going on. We're going to have to watch both here as the setup is there. It does get a hex. Same time down bottom, they get the kill. DP finds it. Back up top. Still on the hunt here. Slark very low as OpenAI trying to find him with the gyrocopter. But now he realizes he's actually on his own here.
Missing top.
As they will they continue? They will find him. He's going to put the mango, try with the Rocket Barrage, but of course with that passive, there's the magic resistance there for the Viper, as this OpenAI Gyro may have stepped a little too far up on the top.
Okay.
As another kill, as they're doing a good job here maintaining that and punishing the aggression of OpenAI up top.
They are, but if you look across the map, there's still a Death Prophet getting free farm and free experience. She just picks up level 6 now, so this means that she's going to be able to use Exorcism.
She's not missing a creep, is she here, really? 20 last hits and 19 denies on this bottom lane.
This is low for a good player. 20 at 5 minutes is pretty bad. Usually you want to be around like 30 at this point, 25 minimum.
But the denies, but I mean, so the experience different, right? It's going to be punishing it. We're seeing it here. The Necrophos, who already suffered against the OpenAI down bottom, comes to mid. He's underleveled, gets punished. Now the Viper, also in trouble. He's trying to bring down the Witch Doctor with him, but he won't be successful. As OpenAI pick up another, and with the Ghosts out, can put some pressure onto this tier 1 tower mid.
Now, if we take a look at the win probability right now, this may look like your standard win probability, but this is actually tied into exactly 90s. This is what the bots believe right now. It's not just based on a typical Dota Plus win probability.
Quick turnaround here with a missile and Rocket Barrage. Lion's got the Hex. There's no mana left on the Gyro, but he can look to give the long run down as he has boots and the Lion does not, so OpenAI. Oh, the stun! Is it enough to save him though? This Gyro is going to continue to chase and he will actually give up, so Lion will be able to live another day.
Good for him. I mean, he's going to have to walk all the way back to heal and all, but at least it does spend some of the Gyro's time. But in the meantime, the rest of the team is actually just pushing mid and they've been here this whole time. They're already working on the tier 2. This is one of the really good benefits about Tide in this case, that he can actually just tank creeps and kill them with Anchor Smash. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Another ward under the tower. Just getting prepping, you know. That's all. Death Prophet's going to come back, though. So it looks like they do want to defend their towers. That seems to be a really big priority for them.
So they can find any sort of setup. Death Prophet actually taking a lot of damage, but the Viper taking that little bit more. He's going to try and retreat the tower. The Verified doesn't save it. Tries to keep himself alive, but OpenAI, they are in, as you say, and they do defend that tier 1. Stop it from taking much damage at all, and in fact, still mid lane. The tower will go down.
Good deny.
They do get the deny, but it's 6 minutes in. OpenAI already taking a tier 2 mid.
I actually think denies are extremely important playing against OpenAI here, because it shows that they do clearly care about pushing towers. So if you can deny that, it's going to delay a lot of the gold advantage that they get from that push.
See if they can get the kill here. He's going to go for the TP. Knows that all the stuns have been used there. OpenAI realizing it's safe to escape. No way for him to be disabled.
Necro only level 4 here. He's just going to be able to pick up boots himself now. This is one of these moments, actually, where you need to split up your heroes. Both Necro and Sark hitting this creep wave is not very useful unless you are planning to push this into the long term. It'd be better for them to split up. One goes the bot lane, for example. Get creeps separately there. Viper on the bot lane going to get a solo kill, I think. This is going to be close. I think he's got it.
He's going to look to dive. And he'll find it. So the Viper not doing too bad at all. 3 kills, 2 deaths. They've got a positive KD at the moment.
He's actually roaming. He stayed in his lane for a couple of levels, and then he's moving around to help the other lanes, and it seems to be working out pretty well. He's going to bring himself more salves, imitating the bots pretty successfully so far.
We'll see OpenAI go back to the push. They'll bring four heroes top, and will take themselves another tier 1 tower 8 minutes in. As we can see already, of course, tier 1 and tier 2 mid taken, tier 1 top taken, and themselves still all three tier 1 towers relatively healthy.
On the bright side, though, they are being relatively efficient right now. Looks like there was a stack off in the jungle here by line. Slark's going to try to clean that up to get some levels, but in the meantime, OpenAI is just getting a lot on the map. Earthshaker's getting full last hits and levels in the mid lane. The four on top are just power-hitting towers, and they've got Exorcism if a teamfight starts. And I don't think they're necessarily getting as much on the human side. They are setting up to defend, but they don't really have a lot of levels. If they can kill the Earthshaker here, this would be perfect.
It's a hard fight to take with the Voodoo Restoration. OpenAI healing themselves up. There's the opening as they look to close in onto the Shaker, but he already got the Fissure out. The cast bouncing as well between the two of them as OpenAI will find the Viper. Will they be able to find the Slark as you see the Shaker trying to chase? Jukes are going to be attempting. It looks like Slark will survive, but back towards the tower. The Necrophos came in. He got punished as the ghosts are out. OpenAI taking another tier 2, taking another kill, and now at 9 minutes in, they're already into the base of the humans and starting to pressure tier 3s.
Yeah, this is pretty much what it sounds like has been happening so far today in all of these warm-up matches against viewers, is that the OpenAI bots are just grouping up and pushing very early. And if the enemy team can't slow that down, it's going to provide this bad situation. They've got to engage now, though. Tie 6.
They've got the setup with the stun, but already so much damage coming out for the Gyro with the flat cannon, just bringing them so low that they have to back away from the OpenAI.
Tide hasn't even had to cast Ravage yet. He's holding this. He knows he doesn't need to use it. If he does use it, his opponents can take the next fight, and that's going to go better, but he hasn't felt the need just yet.
Oh, CM trying to come in from the side, but quick siphon and a blast, and a Fissure will finish him off. As OpenAI finish off the range racks, turn towards the melee racks.
And this is actually consistent with what we saw from the previous game that was off broadcast. They target the range barracks first, whereas in the pro scene, it's always melee barracks, if you have the time for it, obviously. But they're in a big advantage and they're still going range first.
And with these heals, they're just keeping themselves at full HP. Necrophos tries to come forward. He's got the Ghost Shroud, but it won't save him against the magical damage. As Necrophos will fall, OpenAI will clean up. Or maybe they're going to look toward prioritizing kills, and they'll go in with the three-man Ravage. Very nicely done, just on the edge. As he catches all three, the Tide Hunter turns towards the Necrophos. Buybacks are coming out, but it's too late. As Necrophos will fall, OpenAI now 9k advantage, 10 minutes in, cleaning up a set of racks.
They're just pushing so efficiently at this point. Like, they have more levels than their opponents, and they're forcing their opponents into fights that they're not ready to take. Like, their Lion's not 6 yet. Their Slark has barely picked up 6, but Slark is not ready to fight yet. I think Slark has got to be one of the worst heroes in this as well, just because he takes a lot of time to ramp up. And in typical Dota meta, he'll go for something like a Treads, which he has now. Then he'll buy an Aquila, 1,000 gold item. And then he'll buy a Shadowblade, that's like a 2,800 gold item. And before that, outside of laning, he's not doing that much. And once he gets that item, then he starts playing Dota. But that's typically like 15 minutes in. And he's needed to be active from like the start of the laning stage on, and he hasn't been able to do that. So I feel like Slark is actually really weak here.
Gonna see OpenAI ready to go for more pressure as the ghosts are back online for the Death Prophet, ready to have those. They don't, of course, have Ravage still for a full minute, but they're feeling very, very, very strong. Up to the high ground they go. The ghosts immediately out as they push on to another tier 3 tower. The cast coming out, gonna bounce perfectly between the two of them with a Fissure as well. Two more kills for OpenAI.
And they can't even damage their opponents at this point. Witch Doctor is just power healing them here. They've got multiple arcane boots. They don't have a big team fight ulti. They can't get these guys low to even use their spells. I think this game is over.
They're trying to chase down the Necrophos. They'll find him again. Shadow Dance will come out from the Slark. We'll keep him alive a little bit, but the rest of his team will suffer. Fissure onto the CM. The Shadow Dance wears off, and Slark will fall as well. OpenAI just not losing anyone's lives at this stage of the game. As you say, with the amount of sustainability they have, that they're now allowed to, at 12 minutes in, take a second set of racks.
I mean, they're damaging them a little bit, but they're all healed up again. They've got an Urn of Shadows. They've got so many arcane boots here. This is about all they can do. Two racks down, and on the bright side, they've still got a tier 1 tower in the bot lane, so they can delay this for a bit, get a little bit of space, but...
That's true, they got... yeah.
But pretty soon here, it'll be the same thing. Wait, they're just walking past towers, actually. They don't care. This is the fastest way to end the game. Straight to the tier 1.
And they go tight. They will go with Jara to pick up the creeps.
Not Death Prophet. Death Prophet's going to handle this tower.
Oh yeah, she's in. She's tanking.
Yep.
She knows that the heals are going to be there for it to easily offset the damage that she's going to be taking. She's got the salve.
Elba's ready.
Let's see, maybe the last stand here for our audience members as they are 10k behind. This is, I mean, we've got to sort of iterate as well. In a lot of sort of competitive games, we do sometimes sort of see fast-paced, very one-sided. But taking Rex in 10 minutes, that very rarely happens. Even when there is such a huge difference in skill, this is incredibly fast.
Yeah, these heroes are not typical pushing heroes. It's more like they have nukes and heals, and Tidehunter sits in the front and fights, but they also have these team fight skills. Now, if all of the heroes were in this simulation instead of just 18, maybe we would see that real pushing heroes would be far superior. There's not that many pushing heroes, but in this simulation, this seems to be the best ones they have. At least against the enemies they're up against. So this is their final stand here. They've got to take a fight.
They've got to do something.
They got to kill somebody.
OpenAI ready, and there's the Slark coming in from the side. Bam, the Ravage is out. They'll turn towards the CM. She's gone with the Shattered Hearts. Slark again survives for a little bit, but he still falls. It's four heroes dead. OpenAI looking to clean up the fifth, and they'll find it. OpenAI get the team wipe, and they'll move on, and they'll take the game 13 minutes in. OpenAI defeating our audience here.
They made it look pretty easy. I mean, the laning stage looked about even, but it's amazing how fast that advantage creeps.